Do that, it's rolling, and that means we're live. Welcome, folks, to Ratchet Radio, Archer Dawn's occasional podcast. Tonight's show is sponsored by the Iron Vulture and her crew, who've been paying us off with some fancy-looking loot. I tell you, those Sky Pirates are living the dream. So sit back, relax, and listen to these four gents talk for the next hour or two. And Andrigo, keep an eye out for them venture company mooks.
Thank you very much for the awesome and warm introduction. Hello, Argent Dawn, we are Ratchet Radio, and we are back on the air. Thanks to Ratchet. It's an amazing town, amazing fish. Amazing women. Gotta love the women. And today we are joined by three people, other than myself. We have the elf scum that comes from Silvermoon, but has begrudgingly dragged himself here. We have
Edrasil Emberdawn.
Well, finally, someone gets it right.
For once.
From Half Glen, the one-armed paladin who has glowy eyes, we have
Roger Gondrigo.
Fair enough. And finally, we have our guest who is well-known for drawing airships and is an awesome guy, someone we need to credit. He's playing the wrong faction, so he is scum, but we can't call him scum because he is our guest. Our guest today is
Boush, Death Judge, and hey, pal, I'm a steam wheel goblin.
Sorry, I found that funny. Who's clapping?
10 out of 10.
I like it. Good job,
10
man.
Out of 10.
Well, looks like... Hey, mate, you're announced you're out of a job. We got a new replacement for you.
Yeah, you're actually pretty good at that, man.
See you later.
Hey, Archmage, don't think you can fire me, bub. I got a wife, kid, and three shredders. What do you got, a scruffy beard?
Hey. That man has a wife, a kid, and three shredders to feed.
And three shredders.
We're going back with the accents, aren't we?
Yeah, sorry, right.
I thought we'd forgotten that.
We should move on.
We should
totally move on. I'm just holding my blood.
Right.
Anyway, back on topic. Hello, Argent Dawn. Again, welcome back to Ratchet Radio Episode 5. Today, we've got one of the most structured episodes to date, and if it goes poorly, I know who to blame. It's fine.
It's not
me. They've
already
got a gun to the back of their head.
Me. Yep. Me. It's all me. It's all me. Yep. I'm back again. I've ruined everything. I'm so sorry. I regret nothing.
Good boy. Now, of course, first things first is tonight's news. And remember, the gun's to the back of your neck.
Oh, wait, are we actually making him do
that's
something?
Yes.
Come on. What's the alliance been up to?
You tell me, alliance boy. In case you haven't noticed, I'm neutral now.
No, that doesn't work. What was the alliance been up to?
No, man. You're asking the wrong man. I'm here at the last second. I don't have that prepared. I'm not ready for this.
You're asking the wrong one-armed man.
You were asking the wrong Argent Crusader, son. I don't care about what you're storming.
Elf Scum, what's the Horde doing while I'd see what the Alliance has been up to?
Okay, well, we're switching the order then. Okay, so we're going with Horde news. From what I've found out recently, one of the major things, or the most interesting thing, apart from, you know, chilling in Senjin, or sipping wine in one of the many bars of Silvermoon, or, you know, crushing heads in Durotar, recently there was actually something very interesting, and I applaud them greatly for their initiative, but the Thondoril Compact, which is a union between Forsaken and Elves, and I find this really interesting because, obviously, Elves are neighbours to the Forsaken, and I guess there's not as much interaction as there used to be, or as there should be, because back in the day, when I used to, you know, when I was in the Sanguine Eye, I remember, there was a lot of tension in general between Elves and Forsaken, and I feel like we should be getting to know one another and maybe working together because of the fact that we are neighbours and we protect each other, and plus there is an undead Elf leading the Forsaken. I feel like that's a pretty major factor. So going back to what happened, there was basically a demonstration. I feel that's possibly the best word for it, which involved the Rotguard and Blood Aegis moving together through the streets of Silvermoon, using many things like GHI sounds, sort of like to make the procession seem more realistic, and to show that they were together and they wanted to I guess that's the major thing about the demonstration, to show what's going on and why that's such a why their idea should be made known. From what I found out, they all individually in pairs, one elf and one Forsaken, went to Lorth and Martharon and saluted him and everything like that. So that's also a nice idea to show, I guess, the union that they want to project before taking it back through past the Blood Knight Temple and everything. Just, you know, just to show that the guards and everything, that they're not, it's nothing, I guess, aggressive. It's simply just to prove the oneness. So that was really cool. Another thing is, and it's actually quite lucky that he's here with us, but Boush actually drew the Iron Vulture itself, which actually looks really awesome. I'm going to ask you some questions about it later. I hope you don't mind.
I don't mind at all.
I'm glad to hear. So that looks really cool. From my knowledge, we haven't actually seen it before. We don't know what it looks like, and now we do, so that's amazing. I don't know if anyone has seen the film Stardust, but it looks like it looks actually vaguely similar to the lightning harvesting Zeppelin. I don't know if people watch that sort of thing. Maybe I've just shot myself in the foot because it's quite a girly
film. No, I've seen
it's quality Neil Gaiman.
No, I'm
yeah,
glad.
It's a good one. Yeah, it's a good one. I've also taken a bit of inspiration from Threshold Planet, so it's fine.
Nice. But that's basically it. Like, Horde is quite quiet. Not that I could, tell you loads, because I'm doing revision as well, exam period, you know. So I guess that's a bit difficult, but I'm guessing you found something now, Grumpá. I hope you have. Otherwise, I'll just be stammering.
Yes. I found something. Don't you worry, you pretty little faces. As always, it's me to the rescue. So what's the Alliance been up to? Well, honestly, I can't see many major. Sadly, Argent Archives is down at the moment, so we're struggling. We are struggling a bit to try and bring you information, and a lot of the things are coming through us are through word of mouth or rumours, which then we naturally ask about and question and, you know, try and get the scoop. We're like journalists right now, because we've got nothing. But one thing I have noticed is that Gigwin of the Clockwork Collectors thinking of founding a Worm Cult guild. And the Worm Cult, if you don't know, you used to go to Blazer's Mountains. It's Sabaeon and the Black Dragon fight there against Gruul and the Gron. Yeah, that's right.
Gruul and the Gron.
Thank you. Oh my goodness. Too many G's. Anyway, so he's thinking about that. I believe some more information is coming on that soon. It might be Horde, might be Alliance, so you might need to wait or stay tuned. But Gigawin is an awesome RPer. I've RPed with myself personally. I know Andrigo has in the past. He doesn't do anything without knowing the lore behind it first, so it's going to be a good guild no matter what, so I think we need to back it here. We'll definitely give a shout out to it in the future. But also what I've been noticing myself as a mage up here is that there's been a lot of Alliance apprentices or mages around, and it's been interesting because mage RP's been quiet for a while, especially in Alliance. I mean, there's what, handful of guilds. There's myself, the Kieran Toro Soul, there's the Kieran Dal, which is an old guild. A bit inactive, a bit quiet, no one's really sure what's happening. Valvant, if you can let us know what's going on, please get in touch. I'd love to hear from you. And we've got Eye of Dalaran, of course, with Dionidas or Didonus. Don't know how to pronounce his name, never able to. Not the point. And it's good because it's nice to see some new RP talent come into it with the mages and stuff. It's nice to see new refreshing ideas. And of course, it's always fun to teach them the lore, which takes forever. But really, the Alliance has been super quiet, and I'm not sure what I can say, really. I know the Sigil of the Seven are on their way back. I know they're on their way back. I think they've had a period of dormancy, but Xavier's coming back, I think. So I think the Guild's coming back, so that'll be interesting to see. I know there was a lot of controversy, but good or bad, it's still RP, and it still should be respected, honestly. And that's all I can really find on the Alliance side, anyway.
It's a shame about Argent Archives, to be honest. Just the fact that it's gone down makes things a little bit more difficult, especially if, you know, you've got exams and you can't be on WoW that much. The forums aren't as reliable as they should be. But just wanted to say that if anyone wants to, have us talk about their your concept or something that you're doing, please do email us I think that's Argent.
Ratchet Radio ad@gmail.com, as well as you can always send a question to my own personal Ask FM, which is I think going to be eventually converted into the Ratchet Radio one, which is ask.fm/grumpa, no accent on the A. Naturally, both links will be below. Personal message, Argent Archives from me, and I'm sure it could be applied from anyone from Ratchet Radio, including our guest host today, Boush. If you need anything from anyone in AD, be it money, be it tech support, be whatever you need, just let us know. This is a tool that Argent Dawn wants to use and needs to use to survive. All the other RP servers are dying, and Argent Archive sets us out from the others. It means no matter who you are, you can always see what the other faction is doing if you want to. Or you can just keep your own faction, keep your own guild. It's an amazing tool. And don't you worry, we'll support you 100% of the way.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, but there's been good news about the thing about that. They're actually about to fix it completely, but the thing that they cannot maintain it. That's what they said about in the last thread about the matter. So it's basically already almost fixed, but now the question is only when, because the guys don't have time, so we just have to wait.
Yeah, but it's one of those things. You need anything, let us know. If you guys just get in touch, we'll shout you out. It's whatever you just need, just let us know. We're here to help you.
Exactly. And I think that's an important message, Grumpa, because I feel like the oneness of Argent Dawn will sort of support everything, any community project, and I think that's as key for us as it is for Argent Archives.
Oh, definitely. I mean, everyone says Argent Dawn's a very toxic community. Well, we can be when we want to be, but when we need to, we always come together, and that's something which Argent Dawn is good for. We may be tearing at each other's throats half the time, but when we need to come together, we are together, and that's the amazing thing.
It is truly amazing. Should we move on to reading out the emails then? Because I know a lot of people wanted us to do that.
Yeah, I mean, every email we've got up to this point I've personally responded to already. It's just a case of promise to shout you guys out, so here we go. I assume you've got the emails open.
Oh, I thought you were going to have
the emails open.
Oh, you just
I've got everything.
Yeah, you're just sounding like a robot right there.
Yeah, you just the sheep. The sheep returns. Yeah.
Polymorph. Stop casting polymorph on yourself.
It's the Vengerco, man. The Vengerco attack us. They like to attack us. We get some serious threats from them. I've had my wife and child threatened to stop recording, but because
I
love
wife and child.
Yeah, I have a wife and child, and they're, you know, they are important to me. They might be imaginary, but you know they're still important. So
yeah, I know how you feel. I mean, Boush has nine nexus and so many childs he can't keep account.
Exactly. So you wanna make sure they're okay. So Grandpa, why don't we split it like this? You read out the emails, and I will read out the YouTube comments from episode 4, because apparently people would like us to do that.
And I'll grab my Ask FM in a minute. Yeah, we were counting on Andrigo, but I think sudden sickness has taken him again, or he's gone out to fight the Vengerco. One of the two.
I think I sent him to fight the Vengerco. They were attacking, so if there's any disruptions, it'll be them. It'll be the clashes from the outside. He might come back. We never know. We'll see.
If he doesn't, rest in peace. You're a brave soldier, buddy.
You're a brave soldier. You one-armed devil. You.
One can survive just about anything these days, except death.
Yep.
Well, that's something we need to talk about later, that we are debating today. Thank you to Toshen for that. Well, thank you again there at the time, but our debate today has been pre-organised by him, so thank you very much.
And he's returned.
He survived!
He survived!
My god, man, welcome back. How you doing?
I'm letting the team down with my glorious, beautiful blue screens. I really am.
No, it's fine, man. We sent you out to fight the Vengerco. We're just reading out the emails now.
Oh, good. I want to read these emails.
So,
it was pretty good. They started throwing some dirty punches my way. Give them all a kick in the face.
I think one thing to point out there is that Boush has agreed to let us ask him anything that we want. I mean, absolutely.
Anything?
Absolutely anything. Yeah, anything.
Anything.
Yeah,
oh, well. I'm glad I turned up.
So, I'm glad I turned up.
Anything.
The thing I want our listeners to know that everything I have said on the forums is publicly known, and therefore they can be used to ask anything from me. I aim to be a very open person, and I see this as an opportunity to show people that I am indeed doing what I preach. I practice what I preach.
Great, that's what we want. Should we continue with the emails then?
If you want to get a YouTube comment out,
I can
catch my breath and have a drink.
Well, I'll go through the YouTube comments, and then you can go through the emails, and I'll just rattle them out just because I think it just might be easier. So what have we got? So from this first one, that's called Danny Foster, this podcast will be going places, quite enjoyable, and it adds a few more nice touches, one of which is the added music. Keep it up. I did like that comment on our account because
you put in the music.
Yeah.
Not biased at all.
No. Random Smurfing, who is actually Valumar, said, read this comment in the next episode or I shall steal your pointy hat, Grumpá. Kisses. Sorry, Grumpá didn't read that out, but I did. I hope I still get kisses, or that you don't steal my pointy hat.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry.
My hat.
It's okay, Valumar. I'll steal the hat for you. It's cool.
I'll just steal Aratul's then.
Okay, so it just went down.
Well then.
It just went down in HQ.
Next comment.
Crazy Brit Boy, aka Jurdef, goes, damn. Oh, I swore. Damn. So far, this episode seems much better than any before. Grand work, RR team, or Ratchet Radio team. I may have to contact you all when I'm back in WoW. Good luck with the exams. Thanks, man. We really need that luck, because we're all silly. And don't work.
Speak for yourselves, boys.
Yeah, speak for yourself, mate.
Sorry, I am probably speaking for myself. Anyway, next comment is from our wonderful and amazing Sean Baelin. And he says in Defenders of Hev RP style, ah, I enjoyed it. No problem, mate. Manines 11. Yeah. If that makes any sense.
Oh, thank you for finally translating that with me. I never understood what you said.
The cringe. Seriously. No offense, mate. No offense. Just.
I don't know what it means. But anyway, thanks for the comment, man. I'm going to actually leave this next one because that's a topic for debate, which I'm actually going to bring up with our wonderful guest host, guest interviewee person. So I'm going to skip straight to Galhar. He goes, God damn it, started talking to the screen again. I'm not entirely sure what you mean by that.
Oh, you need to go back to episode 2. There's a comment there in episode 2.
Oh, okay. Well, that now makes sense to me. I'll have to do that. I'll do that after this. But that was funny. Even if I didn't laugh, I laughed on the inside. Fix 'em up goes, needs more gnome RP. I feel like might actually be a fair comment.
Fix 'em up is actually GM of Gigwin, so there you go, mate.
There's no gnome RP without ERP.
That's quite disturbing.
Oh man, them vibrate settings, yo.
Okay.
Your Roger is getting jolly, alright?
Okay. And on that note, next comment is from Alaroth Sunstorm, who I know. Good job, guys. I had several moments I died laughing, XD. So, yeah, I think we died laughing as well.
He's not dead if he commented.
That's true.
XD is always a good thing.
Skeletons.
How dare you be sarcastic?
The ride never ends.
Yep. It's ironic because she didn't. But tish. Right, and then Vred obviously did his little first thing. Yeah, and
he's very good at that.
He is, and he likes to keep on, you know, on the ball. I'm happy. It's nice to see such support. Anyway, so rest of the emails, our or Ask FM. I hope we've got some interesting emails because.
Okay, I'll start with Ask FM, which I got. Interesting one. Do you not really respect Edrasil? He's such a great boyfriend. I got that one earlier in the week.
That wasn't me.
You never said!
What?
I never knew! Oh, congratulations! Congratulations!
Thanks, man.
I'm happy for the team. That's lovely to see that, it really is.
Apparently we're going out. Anyway, continue.
Oh, I want to be picked up for dinner at 12.
12? That's really early.
12?
I don't know what you're expecting, but you got to buy me dinner first.
You're older.
Okay.
We've also got one that says, you know, you were saying you'd like to review emails on Next. Is there anything in particular you'd like to see in these emails, or have you sent any old nonsense? To which I responded, send anything you want, just provided it makes sure it's PG-13 and makes sense so I can read it. So yeah, that applies to anyone. You can send whatever you want. I mean, I've got one which just says hi. Yeah, it just says hi. So yeah, you can send anything. It's, well, I will personally respond to anything, if not one of the other guys will. And then we got one which says, make the radio just with you and Edrasil, and whoever the guest is. It's much better, stays on track, and doesn't end in being a normal Skype call that's just been recorded. So, okay.
I'll get my code then.
No!
No, stay. This one I took down with two lines. One is really kind of that person to say it. It's all these anonymous ways, so I can't really work out who said what. Thank you very much for that comment. Episode 4 was enjoyable, and it does work well, mainly because we had Edrasil editing it, and his knowledge of music, when it's not techno, is quite good.
When it's all dubstep, you mean?
Same difference. But there's also the thing where we do this to be a tool to the community, we'd also do it to have fun. I mean, I don't think any of us would be here today if it wasn't fun for us to do, because to make something like this, it takes us a lot of preparation. It may just seem we turn up and talk for an hour and a half, but actually, a lot of our time during the week we are spent either doing things. I mean, I spent a lot of my time writing the lore segments, or sometimes finding guests, or responding to emails. It takes time. And really, without having people like Andrigo on board, just being me and Ed, we'd struggle to get the thing running, because to get one episode of Ratchet Radio out, it takes about 4 hours of editing, plus at least 5 people.
It does take more than that. It took me a good 6 hours to make sure that everything was going okay. If you think about it, it's, you know, more than an hour of footage that you cut down and you edit, and then I do a special way that sort of makes it run smoothly, or at least when you're using basic programs like Windows Movie Maker, it does take a while, but it's really enjoyable. I really like doing it, so I'm not complaining. It's not me complaining, I'm just saying that it takes a while, so one of the main things.
No, we appreciate that comment. It's just one of those things, if we can't really do it by ourselves, when I say it's the RR team, I mean it's the RR team. It's the RR team is a lot bigger than the people you here when we talk to you. There's a lot of behind the scenes work, and we often don't thank those people, but we do appreciate it. We don't thank them publicly, but we thank them privately, because sometimes they don't want to be declared who they are and stuff, so we take that into account. There's one more which I can perceive as a little bit spiteful, so I'm not going to read what I'm out, and you've got your answer to that, so if you want to, if you know who you are, it's I responded, and I hope you appreciate the answer. That was sounded a lot more grave than I intended it to.
It did. I feel somewhat sad.
I will find you, and I will kill you.
I'm in possession of a particular set of skills.
Stop reciting for Taken. I've already told you off for that.
But I think one of the main things is that we also wouldn't be able to deal with
And again.
Hold on. We're being attacked by the Venture Co again. I think there's is it coming? Is the dreaded lag happening? Can people hit? Are we okay?
Do I have to go back outside?
Yeah, I can hear it a bit, but it's fine. No,
I think we're okay.
Okay.
Grumpá, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
Just ready to read out the next email.
Okay, I was just gonna say quickly that also we wouldn't be able to deal without Ben's amazing Irish accent, because Andrigo's amazing Irish accent. I didn't say his name. Because I'm terrible.
Sure you didn't, lad. Sure you didn't.
I'm terrible at it, and I can be good at it at times. Give me a couple of pints and I'll be fine. But no, I just want, you know, I feel like it is a team effort, and it's really good to work with these guys. So anyway, so next email, sorry.
Yes, that was AskFM. So again, it's ask.fm/grumpa, and ask anything, I'll respond. Anyway, we got an email from, I'm not going to say the email because I can't really do that without getting shot in the foot later. I like my foot. There's two emails. I got one 6 days ago. I got one another 6 days ago. Just two emails. Interesting. Would like to say I really enjoy the podcast. Keep up the good work. Also, calling all dwarves to come to Isle of Forge for the Moira. And that is Blackfire. I will butcher your name. I apologize entirely because I butcher everything. And then PM, Iron Forge, has become a lively hub for quality RP. Come to Tavern of the Sea. I'm going to make a dwarf alt after the show, I believe, and I will come find you lot and RP with you. So there you go. Then we have someone who's very, very nice, and this guy is known for his timing. This guy is known quick. Guys also know to comment every episode first and be a strong support of us in form. It is from Red. It says, love listening to the podcast. It's nice to hear what's going on AD apart from all the drama while I'm away from the game. Yeah, we do try to do our best. So by all means, keep going with it. Besides, where else can I go to YouTube to post the first comments, or at least try? Your friendly neighborhood necromancer, Red. And thank you very much for that, and I have sent you an email regarding future appearances, perhaps. So if you want to get in touch with me on that, I will send you another email on my personal account on there, so you can get in touch with me regarding anything you need. And that's pretty much every email, as far as I can see. Oh, no, there's one more. From Galhar. Hi. I responded with hi.
That was it. Hi. So,
That was just it. Hi. So.
Hi, Gahar.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, Gahar. Yeah, nice to hear from you.
Thanks for the input.
Yeah.
Really appreciate it.
Just hi. Yeah. Hi.
Hi. Right, I think. Yeah. You go. Yeah, Grandpa, it's your turn. Yeah.
Sorry.
With that said, my throat is burning from all the reading, and I think we need to go take a break. I need to go rehire the guy who's in the announcer booth so we can come do some announcements while we're away. And then we'll come back and see what everything's going on. Because, I mean, we've got our guest interview with Boush. We've got my Wolves Drunor lore, which is far overdue and probably not worth all the hype. Drat. And we've got our debate of the day. Thanks to Toshin. I think we've got another one. Thanks to our good friend Edrasil. So, yes, guys, say goodbye for now, everybody. And we'll see you in about a minute and a half.
Do you want to be oppressed? Do you feel like your life lacks order and domination? Do you have the desire to have a tyrannical queen making every choice regarding your life? Then look no further than the Legion of Chaos. That Black Queen's a real doll.
Thank you very much for that. Sorry I fired you earlier. Don't worry, you are rehired. Your children will not starve anymore, and your shredders will be absolutely fine. I promise. Look, go away. Stop crying. Has anyone got tissues? There's something worse than seeing a crying goblin.
Why is the goblin crying?
A crying gnome is even worse.
I think he got emotional. We rehardened. Bless him.
Yeah. He must have been.
Anyway, Welcome back, Argent Dawn, to Ratchet Radio Episode 5. We are the Argent Dawn Podcast, blah, 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 blah. You get the idea. What have we missed in the break? We had another Venchko attack. We lost 3,000 men, but we weren't the Grand Old Duke of York. What else happened? Deathwing has returned and shattered the world. Oh, wait, that's already happened. Gaush Hellscream's had his trial. Yes, the War Crimes came out. I've got War Crimes for my birthday, which was on the 16th.
Did it actually come out?
Yeah, War Crimes came out a while ago.
Why did I not know this?
I've literally got it right next to me.
It's because you've been stuck in your freaking den on the Blood Thistle, man.
Yeah, I know. The Blood Thistle is really tough, okay? Just let me be addicted. I have issues and you don't understand me.
Don't you have Sunwell for that?
No. No, Sam Wells is a different thing. Blood Thistle's a whole new
it's
level.
It's not the same.
It's a whole new level of addiction. Anyway,
I was hoping we'd have professionalism. Anyway, War Crimes is out. I've got it for my birthday. Really recommend it. It's an amazing book. Just finished it a couple of hours ago, actually. It's very good. And it sets it up nicely for Walls of Draenor and made me pumped for it, even though it's just going to be an orc expansion. But anyway, so before the break, I said there'd be Walls of Draenor lore, but that's not coming yet, so don't worry. Stop the riots. The riots will be coming soon. But first of all, we've got the man who can draw a vulture, which is not a vulture, it's an airship. I never quite understood that, but anyway, it's Boush. So, Boush, first question, why a goblin?
Okay, sure. Why a goblin? Well, ever since I started playing Warcraft games, 10 years ago, ever since that time, I've been in love with goblins. I managed to play Warcraft 2 and 3, and I just loved how the goblins were displayed in the game. The thing with goblins is that in the Warcraft series, they are so much different than in the World of Warcraft. In World of Warcraft, they are all hyper and greedy and very extreme in every single part. But in Warcraft 3, they were more like adventurous little people who wouldn't care if it was dangerous. They would go and blow it up or die trying. That's what I love about goblins. You can be anything with them, and you can have a good reason to be anything.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, to me they sound quite like the gnomes today. If that makes sense at all. Here's the thing though, you've told me before in conversations that you think that the way a lot of people roleplay goblins can be seen as interesting and not quite how would you perceive them, always just blowing things up. And you said you took your while to find something different. Do you model yourself on any goblins we see in the lore? And also while we're there, is there any goblin that's your favourite in the lore?
Absolutely. Gazlov. He is my idol goblin. He's what goblinhood is about. He's a guy that has been helping the Horde ever since they started making business, and he's a very, very leaning towards the Horde, even if he remains neutral. And that's what goblins are about. They are about doing merchandise, doing trade, but on the other hand, they are not cold, emotionless guys that only look after money, but they do make relationships, similar to any other race. And that's what I think goblin roleplay is about. And the thing with most roleplays these days is, in my opinion, they play too much about around the fact that time is money, which it is, but they don't really consider that even a goblin most certainly can like relate to another race and have like a good chat, a drink, enjoy a good time. That's how I portray goblin roleplay myself.
That sounds quite good. I know. Edrasil will want to talk to you about the airship first, but before he does, I mean, I know you've hosted quite a few events in your time across your many, many alts, and your most recent being the barbecue, which we featured last episode. Again, very sorry that came out later than we had anticipated.
It wasn't made by me. I was just participating in it.
That was our wonderful space goblin.
Yeah, who died. Sadly. Boush was
See you, space goblin.
There's so many goblins these days, I can't keep track. I mean, every time I get a goblin wrong, I need to stab myself. That sounds wonderful.
But yeah, I've done quite a few events in the past. There's like the Halloween balls, both have been made by me, and then there has been an old friends gathering that was like back 2 years ago, but that's a very old one. But the Halloween balls are basically the ones I'm known about, and even those events are actually completely made by me. Those events started a long time back ago, like if we go back like 6 to 4 years, back when I was in Shatta. Yes, I'm an immigrant from Shatta, but
good man from the homelands.
Yeah, there was this undead guild called the Spine, very similar to the Rotguard, you know, from Argent Dawn. We basically had this Hallows and Tall Ones, and there was this guy called Theorius. He was from Sweden, and his character was an undead apothecary. And he had this idea that let's make like a festival around the Hallows End, and that's where it began. But he didn't have time to host it the next year, so I decided to host it. And after that, when I moved to Argent Dawn, I thought that it was such a lovely event that I didn't want it to die out, so I decided to keep it in the Argent Dawn as well. The first year it was kept in Undercity, and the next, which was last year, it was kept in the Barrens because of the rebellion happening. And both have been very successful, and I have got a lot of good feedback from them. So, but I like to make events like, I don't want to make scripted events. I want to make events where people come and socialize and make the roleplay around themselves. That's what I enjoy about that event.
Yeah, I know. I that's pretty much whenever I make a guild or join a guild, I always want it to be sort of you make your own roleplay. There'll be some events which are booked, but everything else tends to be your own. Because you run so many events over the years, be it on the homeland or on this alien world, Argent Dawn, what do you think makes a successful event? I mean, when you first make an event, how do you set about to make it successful and make it memorable, really?
I think a good event is made by a good story. If it has a good and believable story that people can buy, it's automatically on success, of course, if the people don't attend. And the thing I've actually noticed is that even if you send requests or invites that come here, people don't either remember or somehow don't want to come. But if you keep sending more and more requests and invites, even if you do it 3 to 2 times, then people will well, there's something actually really happening, and this guy is really trying his best to, you know, make this event heard, and then they come and attend. The amount of people that come usually make the event, and the variety of roleplay that is mixed together makes a good roleplay. If it's secluded to one group of people, I don't think it's a good event.
Yeah, that's fair enough. No, that's respectable, and I think that's a philosophy that's lost in quite a few people. I mean, you make an event for people to enjoy, and you shouldn't really. You said really you should. While it's a successful thing, it's about having fun, not necessarily having the numbers.
Absolutely. It's all about having fun. You don't have to be overly serious. You just have to loosen up a bit and have a bit fun. That's what I like to think, that everybody can have fun. You don't have to be too serious about things.
That's one of the most honest and, in my opinion, correct views we've ever got on Ratchet Radio. Constable Edrasil, I've finished interrogating the subject, if you'd like to take over.
Alright, so you thought that guy was bad cop, now I'm going to be bad cop.
Okay,
I'm actually gonna ask you about something that's nothing to do with RP. Both you and I, Boush, are PvPers, and we've actually PvP'd together before, although you might not know. Basically, I wanted to ask you about, well, I guess it is about RP, but it's basically in relation to this comment that we got on episode 4 by someone called Kent Toft Nielsen. So I'm going to read it out, and then I'm going to ask you my question. It goes, unrestricted PvP versus restricted PvP, or I guess RP PvP. The negative thing about unrestricted RP PvP is that I, as a roleplayer, have to take time from RP and spend it in arena or BGs. Not because I'm lazy, but simply because I have other priorities. Why should I be punished in that way because I'm not interested in the other aspects, you know, than roleplay? So I guess what the message is that why should it be unrestricted RP PvP when the majority of role players who I guess seemingly want to take some interest in RPPVP don't want to have to take the time to do arena and BGs just to get, you know, good level gear in order to compete with people who actually do I guess PVP in their spare time. So my question to you is, what are your thoughts? Because I know you have said quite a few times on the forum that you would prefer unrestricted RPPVP, but I want to know why specifically.
Yeah, I can tell you why. Actually, the funny thing is, I was completely against the unrestricted PvP 1 year ago. What has led to this change is that I decided to, well, I'm a very, like, if I don't like something, well, like Abraham Lincoln himself said, I don't like that man, I better get to know him better. So that's exactly what I did. I tried a bit of unrestricted roleplay in PvP, and I noticed and I realized that how stress-free it was. Nobody was whispering the other side that hey, your guy is doing this and that, and while you have to wait that guy responds to you, another guy is already doing something. And like in the last episode, like Sean said, it starts to make a snowballing effect until all hell breaks loose. So that's my first argument as why I like unrestricted roleplay so much. It's a lot more stress-free, and I can prove this by pointing out at the various events in the past, such as Borderlands, the Ashes of Draenor, or anything like there was a third one that I can't recall now right now, but every single one of those threats. Oh not spine. But every single one of those roleplay events, if you can actually check it out for yourself, Borderlands has an 18 pages long rant about why some guilds are doing this, or some there have been so many occasions where like people are complaining that others aren't playing by the rules. But when you compare to that to the spine of Kalimdor, there is 2 pages of rant. So just by looking at the amounts of how much flaming and like time spent from the actual roleplay to like screaming the other spies, you did this wrong, you can't do this, is compared to the unrestricted PvP, you can only see that the fact that the other one is a lot more stress-free. But I think the biggest question about that it's a very hard one too. When people in that question, he said that why should I be forced to farm gear in order to roleplay fight against others? Well, there are many factors to take into account. For example, if you roleplay your character as an footman, And another role player that they say is, for example, a hero, comes and rolf stomps you down like a weed. Well, what did you expect? Isn't that how it's supposed to go? But anyway, let's take another scenario. Let's say that there is a person, Jack, who is a role player who role plays a powerful character but doesn't have PvP gear. The player Ben, on the other hand, roleplays also a powerful character with a PvP gear. And now comes the problem. Why should the guy have to farm for gear in order to defeat the other? Well, I can ask right back at them that why should I be forced to use like rule systems such as rolling, or like restricting my abilities that are not in the way Blizzard has designed the game to function. I think that the most best way to play the game is to abide by the ways Blizzard has implemented the system, such as the PvP system. Of course, there are flaws to it, such as balance issues and the like. But overall, I think with the arguments I have like said before, I think it's simply the best one. Of course, I still, like Fine said in another thread, I like to think that there is place for unrestricted PvP, and then there is a place for restricted PvP. I do both, even if I prefer the other. the best way to handle these things is to have a little bit of patience, have a little bit of understanding, and have a little bit of understanding for others. Not being a dick to others. That's the main thing to remember here.
Okay, great. Cool. I think that's a really good answer. That's perfect. I think that's I think one of the best things you said in that was that when people go, oh, why should I have to grind PvP gear? Well, I guess what you could say back is exactly as you said, sort of, why do I have to take part in roles which doesn't display any skills at all other than luck? It doesn't represent your character as well. And
absolutely.
In the same way, even if you think that you're a powerful character, a powerful character can still roll a one and hurt himself. So I think that's a major factor. I have no more questions, and we're also pressing on time. So, Andrigo, do you want to ask Boush anything at all?
I'll be honest with you. I was going to inquire about some of the PvP myself as well. It's an interesting topic.
Oh.
But that was just a comprehensive answer. Wow. That's you covered everything in one fell swoop there, friend. That was amazing.
Brilliant.
I was going to make up a little point, if I can.
Yep, sure.
I'm back.
What happened? Oh, okay.
I had an DC.
Oh, the Venture Code get you?
Yeah.
Okay.
The Venture Code attempted to get me off, but now I'm back. So could you repeat your question, please?
Yep.
I wasn't really going to make a question as such. I was just going to, I suppose, raise a point in relation to what was said there about why should I have to grind PvP or why should I have to roll? Could there not be some way, some happy system to kind of come in between a little bit? I mean, neither is going to fully reflect your character.
There was one.
Ultimately, I feel there is no real happy medium.
Yeah, it's
unless
a hard thing. It's a hard thing to implement. I like a pen and paper system, but it's very hard to implement in World of Warcraft because it's a massive universe where it's a very hard system to try and implement. So that we have to deal with what we are given.
Yeah, exactly.
I agree.
Just on the note there, Andrigo, when you asked if there is a system like to go between, I remember one in the Borderlands which was pre-decided roles. And so basically it was already decided beforehand who won, and so the two sides could just kind of have at it pretty much as much as they want, although that was restricted RP PvP. I'd like to see restricted
yes,
PvP. That was restricted PvP. I'd like to see unrestricted PvP with the roles beforehand and just see them go at it, because when we did the event with against the Bear Lane retinue, as when I was on my Blackjaw character, people felt, oh wow, we won the first one, but suddenly they're crushing us and they brought in way too many people and it's unfair, too many people on one side. That's one of the antis against unrestricted PvP or RPP.
Here's another one.
So
it's another one. You will have characters who will literally just farm PvP gear and have over 1 million health and then just go in and just decimate an army.
Well,
single RP character can go in there and smash an entire army by themselves.
That's raid gear though. Raid gear gives you the huge amount of health, and in world PvP
that's what it does.
That's OP, and it is really strong. And you're right, it's unbelievable, and that shouldn't happen. But I think what would be really cool is, in order to make sure that people kind of had some way, if people are willing to put a chance on whoever wins on one side, then I think that way with unrestricted PvP you can just go for it and make it fun.
Boy, here's the thing.
Go on.
I mean, it's a case of you could have three people with 1 million health each versus 300 with 100,000 each. The three with 1 million each would win, where actually the army with a huge amount would win the fight. We're not like what's the name I'm thinking of here. We're not Captain Price and Captain McTavish in Call of Duty 4 who could hold off an entire army of Russians with sniper rifles.
Well,
I
think you'll find in some BGs there's people holding off a lot of Russians in BGs. I hope part of some of the PvP community will get that, because you know when you face Russians.
The Russians are very the Russians in PvP are very good. I hate going against them.
Yeah, Russians are very good, I have to admit it.
They are incredible.
But some of them are actually... Well, of course I could be wrong, but I still think that many of them are using like a macro or something like that. But that's not really related to Argento now, is it?
No. But anyway, moving on, I think we should move to your lore section, because we're slightly encroaching on time. If we want it to be an hour, I'm not going to lie. This after the break, it's been about 21 minutes.
Okay.
We do need to ask him about his amazing drawing of
giant
airship. I suppose if need be, my lore section can kick the bucket for another week.
Well, I think what would be amazing is to actually we could actually almost just have lore section being a complete focus for one of the episodes. And I think if you agree with me, please comment underneath about that. But
here's another suggestion. Maybe as a midweek thing, if myself and whoever can record, because I cannot due to my incompetence, we could sit down and post. If we post maybe Ratchet Radio midweek, we could post to something with lore on the weekend.
Yeah,
maybe.
Absolutely. If you'd rather do that, then we can continue talking about and keep going like that. That's a great idea, and I think if the community wants that, I'm happy to sit down and do the recording. Then we can go and do that. So, I think on that note, Boush, do you want to tell us about the drawing and everything? This is amazing. I think I'll link it in the YouTube information part.
So link the whole thread. Link the whole thread, because there's a wonderful piece of wonderful description that comes with it as well.
Well, first of all, thank you very much. I've been thanked a lot by various people. Iron Vulture, of course, most. But the thing was that I, as an artist, am not like I'm a dog chasing cars. I don't know what to do if I would like. Catch it. That's a quote. But anyway, the thing with me is I get once in a month like vibes that I have to like. Now I need to draw. And this time the vibe ended with me wanting to draw an airship, and then I remembered that since I've been reading a lot of like Fiennes and other Iron Vulture members stories about the Iron Vulture itself, and nobody has quite ever like described how it looks like. We know that it's a being parked in a dock or something like it's a wreck for the moment, and they're trying to repair it, but nobody's describing how does it look like. So I took a mission that I'm going to be the guy that actually attempts to bring to life, and piece by piece I took inspiration from I simply searched from Google as a airship steampunk. And then I just took pieces from here and there, and then I looked in WoW to what technology is there. I didn't want to make it look too high tech. I didn't want to make like helicopter rotors or rockets or like jet engines or something. I wanted it to look old fashioned and very Victorian and like a late 19th century look into it. And I was really satisfied how it went. I came out with it because. I knew that the Iron Vulture was described to have a really big punch, as in firepower. So one of my first inventions to it was the cannon wheel on the front. That each time the cannon fires downwards, it has two cannons on two wheels that spin up, and once it has fired, it rotates slowly back up with a cogwheel engine that slowly loads gunpowder into it. A cannonball, and then stuffs them tightly in before it fires again. And that's one of my because it felt very goblin-y to add into the whole airship, not just to make it like cannons here and there. So I was really happy how it came out. And the sails, on the other hand, gave a bit of like a more rickety feeling to the whole airship.
It is really beautiful. I have to admit, it's really well done. I really like the design, as I said earlier. I think you should definitely be proud of it, and proud of what you're giving a guild to work with. It's fantastic.
I didn't ask any gold in return. I don't consider it like a as a like a, I didn't consider it like a, I need to get money for because this piece looks awesome. No, I did it to serve guys that I think by far very one of the server's best role players that have given me amazing moments in role play. I think that it's more of a like a payment for all the fun I've had with them than like you have to give me gold in order to have this piece of art. I don't want to be that guy. I serve the community.
I've got to say, it's very much in the style of something from Guns of Icarus. If you don't have, you haven't played that game, go get it.
No, I have not.
Play that game. It's very good.
Okay.
I've really enjoyed that interview. But for time constraints, should we move on to the debate and have a good, so we don't have to talk about that for like 5 minutes. Just give it a good discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. What is the time limit?
Well, we're basically, one of the main things that we've wanted to do is try and cut it down to about an hour, because like the first episode was an hour and a half, and that was really long, and we've slowly kind of cut it back. It's just so hard to constrain all of this stuff into less than an hour. It is so much. We've got so much to talk about.
What we do is we normally set ourselves a limit between an hour or 2 hours. I mean, provided we don't go overboard, we should be fine.
Yeah,
absolutely. But I think that saying that it has to be 1 hour is like saying you can like make it spill over so much good stuff because you can just make it fit. If I think it should like be flexible. If there's not much to discuss, it could be like 40 minutes. If more, it could be like hour and 20 minutes. But there's like no end to the fun, if you catch my meaning.
Oh, there's always loads to discuss. I mean, between me doing Ben's accent, you know, everything happening.
I think the last episode's hour and 50 was really 15 was really good.
Yeah, that was fine. By the way, we should try not to discuss the length of the episode and burning so much time talking about it.
Okay, what's going to happen now? You're going to ask me more questions or what?
Unless anyone else wants to ask any more questions. Andrigo, Grandpa?
I'm good, thanks.
I'm done. I mean, I've just fallen asleep listening to his amazing voice.
Well, that's nice.
That's nice, yeah.
His voice reminds me of my granddad when he used to read bedtime stories.
Now that's just creepy.
I just need the hot milk and I'm ready to go.
Boush the Cradle Snatcher is there. Beware the Cradle Snatcher. That's going to be the episode name. I've decided.
Hang on. I'm invoking my right here. Before we go off into madness and it becomes just a random Skype conversation, we need to move on to our next thing, which is debate of the day, people. This came from Toshen earlier in the day when I was mucking around on the forums causing problems as I always like to do. Well, not always like to do, but you know what I mean. So, he says, I think something interesting to talk about in the show would be the idea of character consequences and the mixing of IC/OOC, as in whether or not it's immersion breaking to agree on a character's consequence with someone rather than simply trying to bring them about an IC means alone. I can't read for buggery at the moment, as this could be seen as unfair. Now, myself and Edrasil have talked about this a bit before, because when we were sort of getting to know each other for episode 1, we discussed where we came from and stuff, and he'll most likely talk about his experience in this former RP realm. I know Boush and I have the Shatar to talk about, interesting enough, because we were on the server at different times and at different stages during its decline to see maybe what its history was for me and for him to see what it became. And I know Andrigo came from another realm entirely, and I haven't asked him about it. So, I mean, if we could start maybe with Andrigo, because I know nothing about it and I'm interested.
So you want to know about where I've come from?
Yeah, and what was sort of the RP, what was it like? Because we know in Argent Dorm, it's very much like, if you want to kill a character, you have to ask the permission first. So what I'm trying to get at.
Okay, right. I have a little story to share.
Yay!
Story time.
I have a story to share now, right.
Sit down and
get
me
milk.
Sat down on my lap. Story time with Andrigo.
See, you can do it now. You did it.
Yes, I did
one
it.
One episode late, you did it.
I did it.
You English bollocks.
Wow. Right, okay, I'm offended
okay,
now.
This is where we get... Okay.
You said you're offended.
I'm offended now. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, I love you really, baby.
Thanks, man.
Anyway,
I mean,
you were
honey.
Saying Earthen Ring.
Wait, what?
No, he's not from... Are you from Earthen Ring?
No!
Okay,
no.
Good. You just get you confusing the two
ring.
Of us.
Is that server even alive anymore?
It is alive, still. But anyway...
No, he comes from Dark Moon Fair.
I am from Dark Moon Fair, exactly.
I was catching his attention.
Okay, Dark Moon Fair. Never heard of it.
Yes, because it's possibly the quietest and most questionably worst of the role-playing servers in Europe. Yeah. I mean, everywhere you go is dead. I was on the forums recently. There's nothing there. There's nobody around. They've merged recently, I think. I think it was Earthen Ring merged recently?
No, it was Dark Moon Fair, Steam Weedle Cartel, and the Shatar.
That was it, Steam Weedle, that was it, yeah. It's too little too late, really. It's a dead place. Now, when I was there, when I was active, this is about 4 years ago, it was, there was a community there, because I started roleplaying there. And, I couldn't have if it wasn't a community. I made the character I'm still running with now. Andrigo's a bit of a... He's getting on in years. But, we didn't have the social, I suppose, the sheer amount of etiquette that Argenton does. Like, that was a huge culture shock when myself and my friends moved over. Huge, huge shock. I mean, where was Dark Fair? It was... Yes, there was problems with it, with the lack of community and the lack of cohesion and the power grabs being made by people because there was few around to contest them or, enforce some sort of logic in the matter.
That sounds like a Wild West.
It really was a bit of a Wild West scenario, but I will tell you this. People had respect for one another, and when I say that, in-character questions, in-character consequences and all that, that was just, it was a thing. There was no, oh my god, I don't want you to kill my character, no, go away, I'm ignoring you now, you lawler, 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 lawler. There was none of this. For however good or bad the server may have been, your actions and the actions of others were all respected as being credible, actual things that have happened, no matter what. Now, given that it wasn't quite a server, we weren't plagued with as many of the super awesome ninja assassins who kill everybody forever and are grim, dark, edgy. We didn't have any of that, so, there was no someone just coming up to you in the street, stabbing you in the back and walking away, you have to die. We didn't have any of the grand campaigns Argent Dawn had. In fact, that was one of the reasons I migrated across, because I was hearing wonderful, wonderful stories. But there was never really the discussion beforehand, coming up to a fight going, right, this is what's going to happen, this is what's going to happen. You just went into it, and the unknown was embraced, and it was a wonderful thing. However questionable it may be to say it now, I do recall one such occasion where I defeated, and they remained defeated, three of the bigger, more well-known community figures. I say community figures, but you know what I'm getting at. They were known, they weren't just some random people.
Pillars,
yeah, I was about to say.
Well, two pillars, one very questionable individual, who I was quite pleased to see, in every other situation where he's been defeated in battle or whatever, he always found a way to wriggle his way out of it. So when I was going up against him, I made sure he wasn't going to get away. And he didn't, and he never came back. As far as I know, to this day, he never returned to the community. He never came back to that character.
He's probably on Argent Dawn. He's probably going to listen to you now and hunt you down. I know where you live. And I
given
want you down.
I'm not hiding. But given that his character's name is Dragonblade, and I've seen a few guilds going around with that name in their guild rank, every time I see it, I kind of go, is that... Ooh. This could get ugly. And it never does.
I'm glad. That makes me happy.
Yeah, but that was Dark and Fair. It was crazy. It was a Wild West, definitely. But, something happened. It happened. There was no discussion, there was no giving it afterwards, there was no undoing things. What you did happened, and that was it.
I had a character on Dark Moon Fair. as well.
It wasn't a bad place. There were some nice girls there. There were some very lovely people there. I'm still friends with a lot of people I've met there. Although most of us moved over to Argentone. But it was a nice place to come from. It was a nice place to learn. But I wouldn't go back. I'll be honest. I wouldn't go back.
Yep. We know the feeling, Bal. We know that feeling.
Nope.
It's I don't know what it is about Argentone. It just gets to you, you know?
It's sunk its teeth in, and now you're stuck.
Yes, it has.
Who's next,
like,
then?
The first addiction.
I feel like seeing that Grumpá and Boush both came from the Shatar, we should go with our sort of backwater people, seeing that most of the Argentone community came from Shatar, I feel. Should I go next, then?
You go next.
Okay, so I'll be really brief and say that Earthen Ring was I'd been there since Vanilla, since the first day that WoW came out, at age 12 or 13, something like that, and I stayed there until about 3 or 4 years ago. It was great because in terms of IC consequence and everything, it was an unwritten rule. At least the guild that I was in, the rule was that if you got in a compromising situation that there was no logical way to get out, you would die, and that happened. I think my character killed maybe 15 characters, other people's characters, not NPCs, actual playable characters, within my time. So it was about maybe a year of playing him. Yeah, good 15, because I was a criminal character player back then. And that was the way it went, and I'm pretty sure I've had a couple of my characters die as well. And you do feel sad when they go, because there's a lot of time you put into them. But that was the whole sort of icy consequence thing. And there was actually the story when I came to Argentone with my ex-girlfriend, just to see what it was like. Or sorry, my ex-girlfriend. There's no.
There will be questions after the show.
No questions. basically, she got into a position. I actually happened to be at work at the time. She got into a position where some other person kind of invited her on like on a date, and her character went along. Even though she was meant to be with Edrasil at the time, and ended up getting sort of dragged into the R word, icy thing, you know, that compromising thing. Yeah, she ended up getting dragged into that kind of roleplay. And from coming from ER or Earthen Ring, it was always roleplay that you go with whatever happens, and you never sort of like try and use OOC to kind of get out of a situation. That was looked at really badly. You'd always try and stay IC, and so she stayed through it and she sat through it, and it actually made her really hate Argentone and never come back. And I think that is a major stark difference. If you in Argentone, if you don't like it, you say it OOC and you go. You ignore them or you do whatever. It's way more on that sort of level. So this is my personal RP space and I don't want it to be breached. On different servers, it's completely different. So I think that's one thing I have to throw in from there. So I'll hand the baton over to you, ex-Shatarians.
Boush, you can go first because you came on. You were on. You've been on Shatar longer than I had, and I was there at its demise where you jumped ship pretty late or pretty early when it began to die. I was there when it actually died.
It's the thing with the. I remember a lot. The Shatar was a complete opposite to that. I think most of the roleplay I did with Spine was pre-planned, and that's why I actually left the guild a couple of times and then came back when my friends asked me to come back, because everything was so planned that every single step was scripted, and that seemed to be a rule. You had to before even battle, you would have half an hour discussion that how my character can do this and beat yours. Well, my character can do this to defend himself and do this to you. Well, my character on the other hand has this laser cannon he can point at you. Well, my character on the other hand has a mech robot to do something like that. So. It was that hectic.
That sounds crazy.
It was crazy. That's one of the reasons I just grew entirely bored of Shatar roleplay. When I came to Argentone, I know that I've listened to your stories. I think that Argentone is much like a hybrid, but then again, it makes sense also because every single roleplay server is merging into Argentone from others, or transferring. So so it makes sense that it's a mix of these styles. But I think that on the other hand, I'm gonna pass that. I'm gonna give the voice back to Grumpá before I say anything.
When I was on Chital back in the day it died, I pretty much got to max level the weekend it died, because it was slow to kind. We had a weekend, it died, and then we pretty much tried to hold the realm together from there. Eventually, RP became an one inn in Stormwind and the occasional guild expedition elsewhere. Quite unfitting ends to an amazing guild. Guild server, rather. But when I was there, this is long after you'd gone, actually we'd reverted to a state like Earth and the Ring and Darkwing Fair. We'd become that. And that in some ways is good, because it would limit yourself to where you were. You wouldn't take a risk. I mean, I had many characters. The only one I took forward from Chital was Grumpá. I mean, Grumpá was an old man. I didn't take many risks with him, and that's something I then built into his nature, and he's now cautious. So it did help me character development, but there was also the thing where there was guild rebellions, and see, that was interesting because that time there were a lot of tensions with Raid, and there was a where OOC and IC crossed together. OOC became IC. However, every action was taken on IC and then OOC be respected, which is something we don't see on AD. So Chital, once it began to collapse into its inevitable death, became that. And that's something that I find interesting to hear Chital's past, right, because it's a lot different to how I remember Chital. I've been here on AD for a couple of years now, so I sort of get into the swing of things. I think about AD, though, it's a bit... It's good that we are courteous, but we are too courteous in a way. I mean...
Yeah, I totally agree with that.
I've made 12 characters in Argent Dawn. 7 of them have been killed. They've actually asked me if they're going to die, and I've said, of course they're going to die. There's no way out of this. And it's... Argent Dawn's good because it does ask you things. I mean... sometimes it's ridiculous. I mean, just a gunshot in Stormwind and you're meant to just be dead. How's that meant to work?
Yeah, you're just having a walk across the street, having a chat with your guy,
and then bang, you're dead.
And then somebody jumps before you. Yeah, of course, some person can say that. Well, that's roleplay. That can happen. What are you gonna do? Well, but it's not fun. It's not serving the roleplay. It's only fun for roleplay is about, in my opinion, about cooperation with other players, not about just enjoying for yourself. It's not like that. It doesn't work like that.
I think it's also important to remember that that sort of thing happens in real life, and we're playing this game to escape real life. So can we, as much as I love realism, I don't want too much realism. So it's like I'm walking into Brooklyn, you know. When it's Stormwind, I'd like to see, you know, the cooperation that you're talking about, and I think that's one thing that we can all work on.
Well, yeah.
Just to butt in for a second. It is something that people do seem to lose track of sometimes. That it's a high fantasy setting. It's wacky. It's crazy. I mean,
you got the bloody heck, and goblins.
Well, that's part of it. I mean, look at the technology they produce, and look at the craziness that comes with it, and that it fits. It works. This is not some grim, dark, HIV-RP setting. This is... It's Warcraft.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's lighthearted fun. I mean, Christ.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I concur.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I completely
the
concur.
Thing with, the thing with World of Warcraft realism isn't in any way similar to our world realism. It's a smelting pot of different sorts of roleplay styles. That line belongs to Fine, by the way, so I'm not gonna steal it. But anyway, I think that in real life we don't really have... If somebody shoots at your head, there's little to nothing you can do. But in World of Warcraft, if you're shot in your head, if you are a dead knight, you might have, like, shrug it off. a bit with your helmet, or a warrior, or if you're a mage, you can just, like, make a ward, or if you're a master rogue, you can just, like, dodge the bullet. If you're a monk, you can catch the bullet of the air. If you're a hunter, you can also dodge to the side, or use an armor, or a shaman. But the thing is, in World of Warcraft, we have choice, and actually to the point where everybody said that there is no point of escape from several situations, actually that's one of the extreme points I want to, since we're going to have a debate, I want to point it out, because people are saying that there are situations where you cannot escape. Well, in World of Warcraft, you have just about anything to escape from any situation. For example, if like in that situation, like I described, there are several ways to survive from it. But now comes the grand question: does it serve the narrative? And that is that. I mean, we have seen like things that you can resurrect people. You can use a light or any other healing source to heal even the most grievous of wounds. But sometimes they don't. On the other hand. And this is the big thing that people have to realize, that if it serves the narrative, it's okay to do, but if not, it's not really a good thing to do.
Exactly. I think that's good.
I think the truth of the matter is that no matter what home realm we come from, this is Argent Dawn. This isn't home for us anymore. We are this is effectively America, in many a sense, is. Because we've got America. you're getting immigrants from all over together, and you're making a great server out of it.
So if this is America, is that why Storm? No, so if this is America, is that why Stormwind is broken?
Yeah, that's precisely why Stormwind is broken.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think. What's California? I don't think Durotar is California.
Finland is Northrend or Norway.
Lapland. To be honest, I don't think anyone wants to sit on the Lich King's lap. I'm not going to lie. It might be cool.
I don't know. I mean, I want a new rune sword for Christmas.
I think there are some girls who might, you know, enjoy the icy touch, as it were.
Okay.
Anyway, as we're getting on to that topic...
Does your ex-girlfriend...
Let's not go into my ex-girlfriend.
let's stick to this topic, yeah?
Sorry. Had to say.
No problem.
Apologise to our guest interviewee. Hmm? Apologize.
I am sorry, Boush.
Yeah, good.
Why? I mean, I do stuff like this every day. Don't apologise to me. I'm actually enjoying it, but we can discuss things like this in an open radio show like this.
So, as Grumpa was saying, sorry, I cut across. I had to make him do
that. We're this is, as I was saying, this realm is different from our home realm. And the question was, should we be like our home realms, or should we be like AD? And that's the question that was asked. And I personally think, like everything with AD, we cherry pick the best from each and amalgamate it together in some glorious child.
Yeah, I think, well, it depends, man. Like, honestly, I don't think we'll ever escape the whole "I have to whisper you if anything's gonna happen." I don't think they'll ever escape.
No, we'll never escape that, but...
And it just because there, you know, that is how it was on Argent Dawn from the beginning. And there are a lot more people who originally started on Argent Dawn. And in that regard, I don't think it will ever do that, even if we're all used to it. And I know a lot of people will go, you know, this is how I like to do it. But that's never going to happen. Even if we'd like to do it, we've all adapted to it. And we've all chosen to do it this way. Because let's face it, if I just suddenly came out and tried to stab someone and there's no way out of getting them, there'll people will whisper me and be like, what the hell are you doing? That's not okay. But on my old server, that would be fine. So, I don't think we'll ever escape it. But it is interesting, and I think, personally, in my view, there should be IC consequences, and that OOC should stay as far away from it as possible, because people start to get really butthurt and really angry about things like that. And I've seen so many screenshots on AD Facebook that it's just
driving me crazy. True. Yeah, that's true, but does anyone else want to comment to this one?
Not really. I mean, has anyone else got another topic we want to debate? I mean, Jake, you said,
Well, about the planning, actually. Because the question from Toshin was that, is planning okay? Well, as I said earlier, I think if it fits the Well, it wasn't actually linked to it, but anyway, I think that planning is, I'm gonna give you an example of my own. For example, when I have been doing roleplay sessions with Ashirawa from the Legion of Chaos, who is a wonderful dungeon master, by the way, we have agreed that our characters are not going to die, and that was that. That's fine. And apart from that, we didn't really agree on anything. And even if we agree that none of our characters would die, some would say that, well, that's taking the fun out of it. Well, not really, because I've had wonderful roleplay examples, even with that in my head. The thing is that if you can make a good story, you don't need necessarily a death. And I think that people are highlighting the consequences a bit too much these days. I mean, of course, there needs to be consequences, but the severity and the how exactly must they be, I think that's highly overrated and how things should go. And there could be also be compromises. I mean, like, this is a classic situation. There is a fight between a person A and person B. The person B wants to solve beforehand what's going to happen. Or the other person, on the other hand, says that, I don't want to. I want to see how this ends. And, if we can also add elements to it, if the other wants a duel, or if the other one wants to roll, or if the other one wants to emote, and then we have a nice big mess if they just can't, agree together what's going to happen. And that's where either comes the conclusion that they shouldn't actually try and roleplay, or they could try a compromise, like I said. They wouldn't agree on everything, so it wouldn't be completely scripted, but on the other hand, it wouldn't be completely, going with the flow. And that's how I like to think about things, that mixing OOC and IC is completely okay. In fact, it's completely impossible not to mix them, because we are humans. Every single thing we choose our character to do is an action that we choose in our heads. Unless, of course, I can't know if you or the listeners are robots, or they have a very drastic sense of, what's it called, double personality, or even more.
They might be robots, you never know, I'm just saying.
Yeah, I never know. But anyway, the point is that IC and OOC are completely mixed, but the question is, how much is okay?
Yeah, I think that's fair enough, and I think that's something we should all consider, and if you agree with Boush on that, or if you agree with any of us on whatever we said, please message us down below, send us an email, ask FM, whatever. We're happy to answer. And I feel like we're encroaching on a serious time. And I feel like, has anyone else got anything else to say before we?
Well, I was just going to chime in for that as well. If you don't agree with anything we've said, feel free to let us know as well, and we shall post a suitable rant for you at the start of the next episode.
And if it's bad, Ben, I mean, Andrigo.
Andrigo, you marks up again.
You blew my cover!
Now they know. The secret is out.
The secret is out. The one-armed man has been identified. No. If you do say something terribly mean, then we'll send Andrigo at you. And he's a very good one-armed fighter, I'm just saying. But no,
I'll fight you with one hand time on the back, seriously.
Literally as well.
I'll stop now.
No.
Basically, as Andrigo said, even if you disagree, please let us know. We'd love to hear your opinions. But yes, I feel like this is an opportune place to stop. I'd like to thank Boush. Thanks.
Yeah, I'd like to also thank the show participants and hosts for creating for taking me into this show and asking me questions, and I really loved how the debate went on, and the things we discussed and I answered to felt like I could really adapt to them, and I think that this has been a wonderful experience. I would love to do it again, but I think some other people also deserve the show, so that I doubt we are going to be discussing again in this radio show for a long while. Maybe in future, but I leave the ball to others as well.
Such a pessimistic point of view, Boush. I mean, you shouldn't just presume that we'd never want you back. I mean, I felt like we've had a connection.
You're my boyfriend, hands off. Leave yeah. alone. You're yeah. my boyfriend.
I'm a wonderful boyfriend.
Well, better kill him. Well, I tried.
Okay, we're going. Thank you very much to our wonderful guest host, Boush. Thanks to Andrigo for actually coming this time. That was it's great to hear your voice.
It's a rare occurrence.
It is great. I know you've battled through potential lack of sleep.
And drunk.
3 days, man. 3 days.
3 days. So yeah, I'm going to say goodbye from me. This was Edrasil, and I will see you next week.
Yeah.
Goodbye.
And
goodbye, Argentone.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
See you.